Good evening. I'm Gordon McHenry. I'm President and CEO of Solid Ground, and I want to, first of all, thank all of you for coming and braving a forecast of inclement weather. I also want to thank you and apologize for our delay. We had one of our panelists who was depending on public transportation, and the doors would literally not open to let her off to come and talk with us tonight. And we are missing... We're missing one of our panelists who I think may be stuck in traffic coming up from South King County. So if she's able to join us, we will we'll bring her up on stage and have her contribute to this conversation. So hopefully all of you know a little bit about Solid Ground. We are a community action agency, been in this community for over 40 years. We work to end poverty. We work to address oppression and racism. And we work to bring community together. And I think all of us in this room know that our region is facing an incredible homeless and housing crisis. There are people in desperate need for services. And we're getting lots of advice on how to address our services, including scaling up rapid rehousing, aligning our services, and I say our, I mean all housing providers, to the federal government's changing expectations and some models. And so we thought it'd be really important to have a community conversation with people who actually are funders and set out those expectations, people who provide those services, people who have been affected and dependent upon those kind of services. And that's the purpose of tonight's conversation. We will have an opportunity for you to make pose questions to the panelists, but our hope is that this is a conversation that starts here, and it's one that continues out into the community, and as a result, we have a community that's more informed, more equitable, and more supportive of those who are in need of housing stability. And I think I have covered everything, and I'll turn it over to our moderator, who is KUOW's Kate Walters. Some of you may not recognize her by voice, but she is a producer of the show The Record, and has extensive experience reporting on homelessness, her and her team. She's done some reporting on what we call the jungle and other related issues. And so I'd ask you to please welcome Kate and to get this conversation started.
I'm actually gonna set myself over here so I don't have my back to the lovely folks sitting in that section. So I'm Kate Walters, I'm a producer and reporter at KUOW, and I am going to be moderating tonight, and I'm going to give you guys a chance to ask some questions of the panelists as well once I'm done. I will ask that when you get that chance that you keep those questions fairly brief so we can get through as many as possible. So before I introduce our panelists, I want to make sure that we're all on the same page. So we're here tonight to talk about rapid rehousing, and who here is familiar with that term and what it means? All right, so pretty much all of you. So for those of you who may not be as familiar, or for those of you who need a little refresher, I just want to give you a definition of that term from All Home King County. So rapid rehousing is an intervention designed to help individuals and families to quickly exit homelessness and return to permanent housing. Rapid rehousing assistance is offered without preconditions, such as employment, income, absence of criminal record, or sobriety, and the resources and services provided are tailored to the unique needs of the household. There are three core components of rapid rehousing, and they include finding housing fast for an individual or family experiencing homelessness, helping to pay for the housing through a subsidy, and connecting those people to jobs and other services that help them retain the housing. So this has become a big part of one of the recommendations that the city has been given in terms of how to address homelessness, and we think because of that it just deserves a little further discussion. So, to tell us a little bit about the way that this could work in our city, what the challenges are, how we could address them, we have our panelists, and I'm just going to introduce them briefly. Catherine Lester is the director of the Seattle Department of Human Services, a rapid rehousing funder and policymaker. We have Maria Williams, who is the program director at LifeWire, which provides rapid rehousing and other services to domestic violence survivors. And we have Rachel File, a UW assistant professor with the Evans School of Public Policy and Government, and she researches nonprofits' influence on solutions to homelessness. And finally, we have Tamara Bauman, a Solid Ground case manager working with homeless families. So welcome, and thank you for coming. So I want to jump straight in, and I'm actually going to pose the first question to all of you and see if all of you can give me a response to this. As we've said, rapid rehousing has become a central part of the federal response to homelessness, and it's also a model that the city of Seattle wants to scale up. So how well do you think this model is working in Seattle and King County right now? And I'll let anyone who wants start. Go ahead.
Well, I would say that rapid rehousing is a really great solution for people who have fewer barriers. And that could be a family that doesn't have an eviction on their record, or criminal history, or past housing debt. Those seem to be the biggest barriers for folks who are in our programs the longest. To address that, I think it would be problematic to view any one type of housing model as a one-size-fits-all solution to the problem of homelessness in Seattle and King County. I think it's not a technical problem, but a problem that is an adaptive challenge that requires all stakeholders to mobilize towards a collective response to homelessness. And in my view, you can't really solve homelessness without the feedback and leadership of those who are experiencing or have experienced homelessness. So I think in some ways it works great for a small population, but it shouldn't be the only solution or the only intervention.
Go down the line. And I will, I think, give in true academic fashion the answer, it depends. But really, it depends, I think, on what we're comparing it to. So when we talk about rapid rehousing nationally, it's often in contrast to transitional housing. And a lot of the research that has been done relates rapid rehousing as an alternative to transitional housing, which after a decade plus of research has indicated is not as helpful as people once would have thought it would be helpful. So we can say that perhaps it is doing better than transitional housing. We can say it's doing better than nothing, right? Maybe leaving people on the street, if we're comparing it to a longer term, more permanent subsidy or permanent supportive housing, then it's not doing well at all. So I think the comparison group in terms of what we're trying to expect is really important to assess how well it's doing.
And Rachel, I'm just going to jump in. You used the words transitional housing there, and I'm wondering if you can just explain to people what that means so that we know what we're comparing things to.
Sure. And transitional housing these are different strategies to address homelessness. And transitional housing has been around longer than rapid rehousing and comes from the idea that people who are experiencing homelessness need a supportive environment for a temporary period of time, usually 1 to 2 years, during which they receive many services that might help enable them to then move elsewhere and live independently. So usually these are residential environments that are very service rich, but they're also temporary.
And for the context of the audience, this is one of the approaches that the city has been told they should scale back in favor of putting more resources into rapid rehousing. So I'm going to continue with you, Maria. How well do you think that rapid rehousing model is working in Seattle and King County at the moment?
Well, I am not an academic, but I'm going to say the same thing that Rachel did. It depends. I think that when you are structuring a rapid rehousing program, that's part of the inconsistency I think that our region has experienced, is that rapid rehousing may look one way for one organization and then wildly different for another. So what we've found, that particularly for survivors of domestic violence, which is the population that I work with, is that when you have a flexible program that allows people to receive not a set amount of months of rental subsidy, but really dig into what works for them and what they need, and then also pair that with flexible funds that can address some of the issues that Tamara was talking about. So can pay back debt, can pay off evictions, can pay other barriers to housing that the family may be experiencing. And couple that also with supportive case management, we call it advocacy in the domestic violence world, that can really help a family get the emotional tools that they need to obtain and maintain stable housing.
So hi everyone, my name is Catherine Lester with the City of Seattle. I would echo a couple of things that the panel has said. I think Fidelity is really important, so I think the city of Seattle is beginning to think about how to increase its investment in rapid rehousing. In the upcoming year, we're actually investing roughly about $2 million in rapid rehousing. That's going to be across about 5 agencies, along with some support to King County, and that will serve approximately about, hopefully, 500 folks. Households, I should say, not individuals. I think households and individuals is a distinction that's important. And, you know, what I would offer is that we truly cannot think of this. This is a really, I just came from a conversation with folks around homelessness. And, you know, one of the things that came up in the conversation is that we often try to address things with kind of one size fits all. And so the original comments about this being an adaptive challenge, not a technical, I think are really important. This notion around, you know, kind of not black and white thinking, that there's a lot of gray. And so we definitely have opportunities to improve the fidelity of how we're doing rapid rehousing. And I think there's an opportunity for us to think about how it's one of many tools in our toolkit as we move forward. So
I'm going to stay with you for a second, Catherine. You mentioned they're one of many tools in the toolkit. How does the city see this approach fitting in with the many other homelessness services that we have in the city of Seattle?
Yeah, so I'll kind of contextualize it around the city's Pathways Home Plan, which is really kind of predicated on three things that we want to make sure that we do. One is that we really want to make sure that we're investing in things that work, and it's why data matters in terms of thinking about that. Secondly, we really want to figure out how to be person-centered, and so not forcing people into a particular resource, but really meeting people where they are. And we also want to make sure that we are addressing racial disparities. So when we look at sort of who is impacted by homelessness, along with a lot of other things, I think that's really important. Rapid rehousing is sort of one of the tools that we want to use, but we recognize that we can't just kind of shift everything, like the pendulum can't shift one way or another, and that we still definitely need emergency shelter, but we want to think about when is the best time for us to use emergency shelter, because I can't imagine that any one of us would ever want to rely on that as our permanent residence. And we know that sometimes people stay in emergency shelter for a very long time for a variety of reasons.
So by emergency shelter, you mean the shelters that people would go to stay overnight if they had no other option.
Definitely. So just kind of thinking about, you know, I'm not a big fan of sort of all or nothing thinking. I think that sort of all of the resources and appropriately tailored to people's needs is really critical.
You mentioned them shifting money to things that work. So I want to talk a little bit now about what we know about rapid rehousing and how well it does work. Rachel, you have studied this, and this is a model that's considered best practice nationwide, but it's still a fairly new model as well. So what does the research that we have so far tell us, and how does that apply to what we might do in the city of Seattle?
So it's definitely, Maria and I were talking about earlier that this is definitely a program and an approach where the practice and funding is pretty far ahead of the research. So we actually don't, we're kind of just starting to catch up in terms of the research and understanding really what's happening. At this point, we don't even know sort of nationwide a catalog of rapid rehousing programs and what exactly that means at an agency level. So what Maria was alluding to, if you walk into a rapid rehousing program at one agency, what might they be offering each client and how might they be doing engaging with the services compared to another agency? We don't know. There are sort of some emerging best practices, but I put that in quotes because it's not, we haven't really tested them as best practices. They're more sort of emerging shared practices that people are deciding are the best ones, and maybe they are, maybe they aren't, but we don't know yet. Some of the things that we know most come out of a randomized control trial study called Family Options Study that was sponsored by HUD, and this had, maybe 11 sites across the country. Seattle was not one of those sites, so we don't know anything specific about Seattle from that study, but it really, again, looked at rapid rehousing compared to other interventions. And when compared to permanent supportive housing, so just a voucher, right? Not even permanent supportive housing, just a voucher, so just housing rental assistance, we saw that the housing assistance the voucher outperformed everything in terms of housing stability, in terms of well-being outcomes, in terms of reducing domestic violence, all of these other things that we might want to get. The housing voucher was far and away the best intervention. Rapid rehousing fell along the lines of almost everything else, except that it appeared to be substantially cheaper. So getting mostly the same results in terms of people returning to homelessness or their housing stability, but not costing as much as either emergency shelter or transitional housing were the other two alternatives.
I want to give our other panelists a second to chime in, but I want to stick with this for just a second because the studies that have been done, they measure success very differently. There are different measures. So I'd love to know, how should we be measuring success in Seattle, since we do have very little information at this point? If we put money into this as a city, how should we know in a year or 2 years whether this is working? And what are the benchmarks that you think we should be looking at to say, great program, or you know what, it just didn't work out? And you can toss it to someone else if you don't want to answer that, Rachel.
Like, oh, for me?
Yeah,
oh, I
sorry.
Have lots to say. I felt like I was dominating.
Okay.
What are some of the metrics? Well, I would like to see something, I mean, I think better defining what we mean. So are we talking about housing stability? Are we talking about avoiding shelter? Are we talking about saving money? I mean, I think those are all different goals that might lead to different outcome measurements. I think some of the things that would be really valuable to look at sort of regardless of how we're defining success would be sort of time from walking in the door to actually securing an apartment. Part of this process is that you're getting housed in the private market and you need to have a landlord and a unit willing to house you. And the agencies are working really hard to make that happen. We know that for some people it can take a very long time. So looking at that time between, okay, you are an appropriate person to receive this intervention, when are you securing a unit, I think is very important to know. And then I think along the lines of the equity priorities that have been mentioned, are we seeing differences across different types of clients in terms of who might be housed more easily, more quickly in the private market based on other characteristics? And I think housing stability is also extremely important. So knowing if people are staying in the units that they're renting, talking either with the clients or with landlords to know what are the experiences once they're actually housed. A challenge of this program is that once someone is housed, there's no mandatory or really easy way to stay in touch with them, because the idea is you've gotten back on your feet. And that's one of the advantages. For people who don't need a more service-rich environment, they can just go back to independent living that they may have been in before. But it means it's pretty hard for us to know where people went, if they stayed in their apartments, if they moved apartments, if they returned to homelessness. We might have some indicators, but it's hard to know.
So Tamara, you're working with clients,
yes,
to put them into housing. What are you seeing in terms of their experiences? And in a city like Seattle, how difficult are people finding it to find a place once they have this assistance available?
Well, it's incredibly, incredibly challenging for families to access housing when there are so many market forces and conditions that might preclude someone from getting housed. I don't think we can underestimate like the micro level systemic barriers that that really harm people and harm families. And so when you're asking about how do we measure success, I think there's a critical piece of client voices. We want to be client-centered and effective, but there's also a lack of client voice in determining services, program design. And so I, as an advocate who came from the DV field, I believe it's absolutely critical to center the voices of families who are impacted by domestic violence or homelessness, to have the core leadership in determining how these programs are defined, how they are set up and administered and executed within the community. For a lot of people to get housed as quickly as possible, a lot of them have to give up something in another life domain that might be important to them, like moving away from their social support networks or giving up access or close proximity to their children's schools or to their jobs. So I think it's really challenging for folks who are living in extreme or even moderate poverty. Then you have institutional racism and zero rent control policies that make it very difficult for anyone to be able to not just access housing, but to sustain housing once they're housed. Even with the subsidy, once that subsidy ends and they haven't met all those program goals of obtaining employment or accessing public benefits, a lot of people are still left in a similar position from when they entered the program. So, yeah, it's challenging.
Maria, you work with an organization that also helps people to get into housing through rapid rehousing programs. I'm wondering, that idea of what happens when the assistance runs out, what do you find from your clients of, is it enough time for them to be back up on their feet? Are they finding the assistance really does get them back to where they need to be? How do they deal with it when that sort of transition comes up?
I think this is where supportive services really play a key role in any sort of housing intervention. If you have a case manager that's walking along beside you in the process and that you've built a trusting relationship with and you know that you can rely on, you're far less likely to become homeless again because you can say to that individual, I don't know how I'm going to make next month's rent, or I can make next month's rent, but I need new tires for my car and I don't know how I'm going to do that. And it's all these really, when you're living on the edge of poverty, all of these very small things to many people that can really push you over the edge and lead to homelessness. And when you're in open dialogue with someone that can actually reach out and can help you and has resources and can sort of work as a resource broker for you, because as a marginalized homeless individual, you don't always have resources at your disposal, it's far easier to obtain and maintain stable housing. I think that, like Tamara was saying, self-selection into programs is essential. I think that we found that if a family really believes that short-term rental assistance or rapid rehousing or whatever you want to call it, because it's called a bajillion things in King County, can really work for you. If that's the thing that you say, no, that's what I need. And I know that because of all these other things that have happened for me in my life, I know that that's the intervention that's going to work for me. But any time that you, I think, develop a program that has really defined restrictions around it can only be this much, and it can only be this long, and it can only look this way, that's setting families up to become homeless again.
Rachel, I saw you raising your hand, and Catherine, I want to come back to you, but I'll give Rachel a chance to respond first.
I just wanted to, I think, present an alternate viewpoint to not the last thing you said, which I agree with, especially about if families identify this as the intervention that they think will work for them. But the statement about that supportive services are important in any housing intervention, because I think actually what we know is for a lot of people it's just affordability. And that's what the research has shown, the study I was mentioning, as well as other studies, that if you can afford where you're living, then it doesn't matter if you have services or not. Maybe it does matter, but we actually see the improvements in physical well-being, mental well-being, children going to school, all of these other things without adding those supportive services. We get those results just from making sure that people can afford where they live. So,
and Catherine, I'd love to address that with you because we've seen success with rapid rehousing in cities like Houston, New Orleans, Salt Lake City, where they have higher vacancy rates, more housing is available, there's just more stock, and also rents are lower. So that's a markedly different situation than we're looking at here in Seattle, where we are facing an affordable housing crisis. How does the city want to make this model work, and how can this model work in a city like this?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a great question. So I was just thinking about also the theme around flexibility. So I think flexibility is definitely sort of access to dollars to be able to be used flexibly. But flexibility is also about sort of the ability to get people indoors. And so we talk a lot about housing first, but the reality is that we don't often have opportunities for people to be housed first. And so thinking about how we actually take advantage, one of the things that the city and the county are doing is really thinking about a remake of our landlord liaison program and really thinking about how do we create a greater sort of lean-in leverage for more units to be available, and recognizing that we've got to do a better job at helping folks that are practitioners be able to navigate that, because oftentimes social workers feel like they have two clients that they're working with. They're working with people who they are trying to get housed, and then they're also working with landlords and trying to kind of manage a variety of different dynamics. And so one of the, I think, opportunities moving forward, and this is not to say that it is necessarily totally easy. I recognize that this particular community around our rental markets is very different than other communities, and yet we are also seeing opportunities in other high rent markets to be able to be successful with rapid rehousing. I think it's about sort of making the choice. Are we willing to do whatever it takes and be really flexible and creative in doing that to get people housed, or are we waiting for a perfect scenario by which people are indoors?
You brought up there the other side of this equation, which is the landlords. And in a market like Seattle, landlords have got a lot of options. You know, we've mm-hmm. got people at really big companies. We've got people who have, you know, perfect rental histories, a lot of money to spare. I'd love to hear from the caseworkers. How do you deal with landlords, and how can we get landlords on board for a system where they do have the choice of someone else and not necessarily taking a chance on someone who has a rapid rehousing voucher?
I've had a lot of success in kind of building relationships with landlords, and they often will call me, a case manager, or their housing advocate if there are issues with a tenant that happens to be living in their property. That has really mitigated a lot of issues for the property to rent to another one of our residents or one of our program participants. So relationship building and collaboration across sectors is critical, because you're not just there for the participant, you're also there for the landlord. And I think that creates a feeling of safety and you know, trust with them that really is just a matter of kind of schmoozing and you know, developing that relationship. It's critical.
I just want to offer, I think that's a really great point, and I want to offer that this is an opportunity for public sector, such as the city and the county, to lean in terms of our ability to have systemic impact. So a lot of times we talk about sort of our work from a service perspective, which I think is, as a social worker, I think that's totally important. But there are some real systemic barriers as to why people are outdoors, and or why, quite frankly, why people need helping systems, period. And so I think there's an opportunity for the city to lean in a different way around the accountability of our system, and particularly landlords and other housing options for the responsibility of this being a thriving community.
The panelist that we're missing tonight is a woman who is someone who has been through the rapid rehousing process. She's someone who had help from the program, and I would love to hear from, Maria, perhaps you could help with this. I'd love to hear the experience that people go through once they do have a voucher available to them, especially if they want to stay in the city of Seattle where the market is so very tight.
Sure, and Tamara can speak better to the city of Seattle specifically than I can. We house people most frequently in East King County and South King, simply because our organization is based in East King County. But what I can tell you is that so much of that is dependent on the relationship that the organization has sought to build with landlords. And I really like the idea. It's not ideal, but it is real that you have two clients. You have the person you're working with and you have the landlord. In all the conversations that myself and my coworkers have had with landlords, what it boils down to is that they're business people. And if you treat them as business people, they're far more likely to respond to you than if you come to them pleading your case. We've been very fortunate that there have been a number of survivors that we've worked with who have said that they want to disclose this to landlords, and it happens the landlord may also have experienced family violence, and that can be something that is sort of a giving back nature. But that is the small minority of instances. This is where we find that flexible funding really, really helps. That if you can offer an increased deposit to a landlord, if you can offer first and last month's rent up front, if you can give them your business card and say, if things go awry, I'm a person that you can be in touch with. And then as a service provider, you continue to make that contact with the landlord over time. That seems to really build that relationship. So much so that when then the landlord has other property available, they'll often call you because they know that, you can get people in quickly. And as a business person, that's what they're looking for. So in working with landlords and in tight housing markets, that's the best success that we've had.
It sounds like a pretty heavy lift from the case manager point of view, and I'd love to know how feasible, I guess, it is to ramp this program up substantially with that kind of manpower needed behind it and that kind of relationship building and time spent. And Rachel, you raised your hand. But
well, it's actually related to the question. So I've been doing some research with the Downtown Emergency Service Center on the implementation of their rapid rehousing program with a single adult population. And in their program, they actually have a split among the staff where they have case managers who work exclusively with the clients, and then they have housing specialists who work in the landlord relationships. And that is, of the sort of many ways that this program can be implemented, that's also an option for sort of splitting that workload, which is something that they've sort of evolved into over time. And some of it came from feeling like it was maybe too much of a heavy lift for the case managers to be trying to manage both. And so the case managers can work with the housing specialists within their own agency instead of feeling like they have to be focused both on the client and in the market. I also wanted to add, though, just related to the market, we did some interviews with both the case managers and housing specialists, and they have sort of fascinating insight into the advice given to clients and case managers about how to find a landlord. And one of the things we heard a lot was to avoid the big corporations, and that the mom and pop landlords are more likely to be open to this kind of idea, and the private landlords. And it's great to hear Catherine talk about what the city might do, because I think that's an area where we think about a housing market dominated by, you know, corporations. They might have headquarters in Chicago or somewhere else. They don't actually have the authority to make those decisions locally. So it's not entirely the fault of the person speaking to the client. But at the same time, if we think about that percentage of our market that's not really available for this type of intervention, and then we're trying to get more people into the intervention, it's going to be an increasing problem.
Well, Catherine, I'd like to know from you, with that idea in mind, that it might be the smaller, the landlord, someone who owns a house. Some of the clients going through rapid rehousing programs do have big barriers. They might have an eviction record. They may have criminal histories. What do you want to say to landlords in Seattle to get them interested in this idea of renting to a rapid rehousing program person instead of, say, someone from Amazon?
Sorry,
that could be a loaded question. So I have two thoughts. One of which actually goes back to your original question about capacity, and I'd love to sort of go back to that because I do think capacity matters. I last month was in a conversation in the Bay Area and with a colleague and who does some system work around returned citizens, otherwise known as reentry, in the South. And he quoted this statement that 75 million people in this country have some sort of criminal history. And that's such a staggering statistic to me. It's a quarter of our country's population. And so when you think about sort of this exclusivity about who you're actually going to do business with, it feels very short-sighted. My train of thought in your original question is, you know, what are our thoughts about sort of the engagement of landlords? And I think the individual relationships are crucial. I'm a big believer of relational capital. But I, not to sound repetitive, but I just think that there's an opportunity similar to, you may have seen in the paper sometime in the last couple of months, the mayor sent a letter basically severing the relationship between the city and Wachovia. or Wells Fargo, sorry, it used to be Wachovia back in the day, Wells Fargo. And it was a statement to say, we're gonna lean in around sort of our leverage as a city to make a very clear statement about who we will and won't do financial business with. I guess what I'm offering and what we're talking about and thinking through is, what does that look like around making units available? And I think part of that is sort of the remake of how we think about our current landlord liaison program and really thinking about what might master leasing look like, or what might it look like to work with folks who are in a corporate environment that have the ability to have real systemic impact when it comes to making units available. So that's, so I believe in the system, the service, sort of one-on-one relational piece, but I think there's also an opportunity to think really broadly about what's the system change that's needed. I also just want to go back around your question around ramp up, and it's something that actually keeps me up at night a lot, which is really this broader conversation about capacity. Capacity is often, there are lots of ways to have working definitions of capacity. Capacity is sometimes defined purely as money. The thing that keeps me up at night really is pure people capacity. And the ability to not only recruit and retain folks who are working with communities and individuals who are such on the margin in our community, but also the capacity to have really strong folks that can stay in it for a long time and have fidelity to a practice. And so I think, I often give this example. If this was a transportation package that we were talking about, there would be capacity around the transportation infrastructure that is needed. And I think that we need kind of a human service infrastructure that really supports us being able to move forward and ramp up new and continue good stuff.
So I know that we've heard, obviously, it's a pretty difficult market to find housing in, regardless of who you are or why you're trying to find housing. And one of the things that was in a report given to the city that recommended that rapid rehousing be an approach that the city puts more focus on, one of the things said in this report was basically the priority has to be to get people housed. And if that means that they go outside of the area that they want to live in, then so be it. If it means they pay more of their income than they would originally want to in rent, so be it. But that needs to be the priority, is to get them into housing. And I'd like to know from the panelists, and anyone, feel free to jump in to answer this, what kind of impact do you think that approach to this model could have in terms of equity and whether or not we're sort of pushing people on a lower socioeconomic rung and people of color outside our city limits by taking that particular approach?
That's an excellent question, and one that I've actually observed in my work as a Journey Home case manager. In fact, one of the participants I work with has actually been priced out of the Seattle market and is now living in Auburn. Because she couldn't afford, even with her voucher, a lot of her options were very limited, and it was difficult for her. And she's actually one of the people that I was really concerned about. She was being priced out of increasingly like a gentrified city, and now is living in a suburb where transportation and employment resources are fewer and further between. So when we're talking about inequity and social justice, she is a woman of color. She's a single parent of four children. I don't see a lot of equity and social justice in a model that says, well, we can't really prepare you for taking over the rent after this 3 or 6 month subsidy ends. I think there needs to be a more intensive focus on community advocacy and what it means to really support people who are the most marginalized or the most vulnerable. There needs to be both a legislative advocacy piece as well as participant input. I just think that I'm going to be the one who emphasizes that until I'm blue in the face.
unless you have the people who are experiencing homelessness at the forefront of the movement to end homelessness, we're going to see this problem again and again and again. So I guess if I was to recommend anything, it would be to start including the voices of people who are accessing our services into the conversation around how do we end homelessness. I guess that's what I would say.
Does anyone else want to? Would any of the other panelists like to weigh in on just this idea that if the idea is to get people into housing regardless of where it is, what that might mean in terms of the racial makeup and economic makeup of the city?
Well, I think it's interesting who that responsibility is placed on. It's exciting to hear that the city has initiatives that are looking toward how to landlord engagement and where funding is going. But as service providers, what we can rely on is what we have. And if the directive is to get people housed with this funding that we're giving you, that we know is going to make all of the difference in people's lives, then that's what we're going to do. And we're going to put every supportive service around it that we possibly can, because that's what we have control over. Mm-hmm. We don't have control over affordability of market as service providers. And so it leaves us marginalized in a case of working with marginalized, truly marginalized people that are then being pushed further and further, further out from where they most identify that they want to be. So I think that for service providers, it's a rock and a hard place, and that you work with what you can and you do the best by the money that's given you and by the people that are needing the services.
And I want to follow up and absolutely acknowledge that the service providers have, I mean, I think at least those I've spoken to, and I think you're echoing that a little bit, if you could wave a magic wand, they would say, yes, we want more affordability. So it's not that they're not doing what they can. Personally, I would like to see greater connection between these conversations about homelessness and various tools for affordability. I think when we're in a sort of service providers, human services space, we tend to think of permanent subsidies as the only option for increasing affordability. And the reality is we're in a city, in a region that also is engaging in a very extensive conversation about how to adopt these tools for affordability. At a larger scale, and they tend to be different people in those conversations, and they also tend to have different supporters and different opponents. So I think, you know, something that I sort of am frustrated in from my corner of the world is that we have immense support for getting people indoors. That support doesn't necessarily translate to what needs to be done to have a housing market that truly is accessible in our central city, in the areas where people want to be, that might be these additional options for service providers to place their clients.
I guess the only thing I would add is I always like to give context to the city's and really the mayor's vision and sort of path around this work. And I always talk about it as kind of three things. The first is the indoors. It's the crisis response. And we spend a lot of time in the crisis, and sometimes to the point of being at times, from where I sit, distracted from some of the other kind of systemic movement that can happen. The second is really around housing affordability and this commitment to continuing to figure out how to generate local resources and rethink what it looks like locally to make more affordability and livability real in this community. And then the third is sort of what we've been talking about, which are the improvements to our homeless system, thinking about how to be much more person-centered and investing in what works and addressing racial disparities. I always sort of give those three sort of contextual points because I think it's important. None of them kind of sit alone or could sit alone. And what I would just acknowledge inside of it is that I think what is a great opportunity, albeit a little more challenging perhaps since the November election, is to really think about what does it look like together to be more coalesced locally in how we talk with and advocate at the state and with the federal partners. And so, because I think some of what we are attempting to do is fill in the cracks of disinvestment that has been 40 years in the making. And you know, the affordability crisis that exists, quite frankly, along the West Coast is a reflection of something more than what local government can fix and solve alone.
One thing that popped out at me with the focus strategies report was the notion that homelessness in Seattle, King County isn't a matter of housing affordability. It's a matter of using our resources more efficiently. And I think that says enough.
I'm guessing that you disagree with that point. Well, affordability is obviously one of the underlying causes of the reason that people need to be part of a rapid rehousing program. Is there a way that we can make sure that the implementation of this program in the city of Seattle and in King County can help to address the underlying causes of why people were homeless in the first place? Is this a model that can help to do that and keep people in housing as opposed to perhaps just being a short-term relief?
I would say that the underlying cause of homelessness is that you can't afford a place to live. So I don't actually see the underlying causes as other things. I think a lot of people do have a lot of challenges, but there are victims of domestic violence who are housed and people with substance abuse problems who are housed. So the not having a place to live is the underlying cause. But there are certainly people who rapid rehousing can and does help, who may actually be able to maintain their housing. They just had some bad luck or a health problem or got laid off from their job but are employable in a profession that might be able to pay their rent. So I think want to get lost in this conversation that rapid rehousing isn't the right thing for anyone because the market's so bad, because the reality is we have people who are homeless who have all of the tools they need to be self-sufficient and for various reasons are not currently able to access the private rental market. So for me, I think it's more about right-sizing the tool and acknowledging what the limitations are so that we can say, okay, this is not addressing this population. What can we do for this other population?
For those who maybe don't have everything lined up yet, aren't quite in the place where if you give them a one-time injection of funds, which is often how it works to help with things like the security deposit and first and last month's rent, which can be very difficult to come up with. For somebody who isn't quite at the point where 3 to 6 months later they're going to be on their own 2 feet, how can we adapt this program to make sure that they're not relapsing into homelessness, if at all? Any thoughts?
Well, I mean, a lot of the service providers and my coworkers have been concerned about the income to rent ratio, and what we think or we hope might help folks stabilize over a long period until they feel comfortable paying rent on their own is looking at how can we do that systems change and make our subsidies perhaps longer, increase the amount of the subsidy, just so that they have the people we serve have a sense of security in taking over the rent and have the capacity and ability and the resources they need to be housing independent. So I think there's some systemic issues that need to be addressed sooner than later, because affordability is such a huge issue. And then you're also like playing with the idea of how can we make things more equitable for people with disabilities, survivors of domestic violence, and people of color, who do have far more barriers than other subpopulations. So,
I'm going to hand it over to the audience in about 5 minutes. I would love for the panelists just to wrap up for me if you could. And Maria, I want to start with you because we haven't heard from you in just a while. I'd love to hear your final thoughts on this in terms of what you would like to see moving forward, as the city does put more focus onto this particular tool, how do you think it could be improved, and how would you like to see it utilized in this city so that it is something that can help as many people as possible?
Sure. The National Alliance on Homelessness has really, really great benchmarks laid out for rapid rehousing specifically. And one of the things that's really risen to the top is that flexibility is the most important thing. That, as you were saying, at times in 3 to 6 months, you may actually be able to take over the rent, but you're not going to be able to do it in a way that you have confidence. And ending homelessness for a family is so much more than just putting a roof over their head. It's increasing their confidence, it's allowing them to be healthy, allowing them to be safe, allowing them to choose a life that they actually want to live. And when we're doing that, putting a program on top of that that says in 6 months, in 3 months, in whatever amount of time, we're going to be out of here and we're actually not going to check in with you and you're going to be on your own, those are the things that I think have resoundingly not worked. And it's easy to fall back into that idea because it's very clear cut and it's very specific. And I would challenge the city and funders to really think differently about it and really think flexibly, really trust the folks that you're funding, that they can best serve the populations that they're set up to serve. And that when you do that, that's when you see a reduction in homelessness.
So I'll bring up something that we haven't used the term progressive engagement at all yet, which is very particular to this program. It's the idea that the case manager does have the discretion to sort of ramp up assistance as needed, but you don't want to start at that place, right? You don't want to give people way more than they need because you want to be a good steward of public resources, and you don't want to sort of patronize people with more services than are actually necessary. So that's one of the sort of values or strategies that's meant to be part of rapid rehousing. And I think even without dealing with all these market level issues, I would like to see some more clarity, I think, in communication between the funders and the providers about what progressive engagement actually looks like and how a case manager is meant to, what indicators should a case manager be using to say, yes, you are a person who could use more services at the 6 month mark versus no, I think that you haven't really been holding up your end of the bargain, so we're moving on. And I think that just communication about that is very difficult right now, where we think of the environment of having, say, a year long contract with a certain amount of money and a certain number of people you're supposed to house. It's very hard to say, well, you're at the 6 month mark, but we still need to house 3 more people, so we're not going to ramp up your engagement and services, and instead we're going to, you know, give some more people their first last month rent and security deposit. So I think something that could be improved just even within the constraints that exist is more communication about how that process should look.
I would definitely like to see more collaboration between funders and providers and program participants. And one of the things that I think we can start doing now is have one of the things I'm personally working on is developing rapid rehousing focus groups for program participants, current and formerly homeless families and individuals to come and share feedback with funders, service providers, administrators, because I think that might change the conversation a little bit if we have input and perspective from a group that hasn't really been tapped into, but are the ones that decisions are being made around. I think I'd like to see a little bit more of that, and maybe including homeless families into the rapid rehousing learning circles. And even thinking creatively about how we can expand our partnerships with like faith-based communities to identify landlords and housing leads, and I think the landlord liaison project is phenomenal, and I think that's gonna make a huge difference. So I think, again, participant-led rapid rehousing feedback should be prioritized.
Catherine, I'm going to let you wrap it up.
Sure. So when I was thinking about today's conversation, there were three things that really kind of resonated with me as I was kind of reflecting. One is that I think data matters. And I'm a big believer, people have heard me say that I don't believe any data is really conclusive totally, and yet it's a critical barometer in kind of understanding where you're starting, where you want to get to. And that stories are part of the data. So I think sometimes we think about data as just kind of widgets that we count, which actually kind of drives me crazy because widgets don't really tell us anything. They tell us something, but not a lot. So I think data matters to having a culture of learning and where we're learning about what makes real impact for real people. The second thing that I was reflecting on is, and you've heard me say this, is that capacity matters and that the ability to have the right capacity to do what we're trying to do well. And that paying attention to how we do our work and do it well. So I think, Rachel, you said, you know, we've got lots of different rapid rehousing programs happening, but they don't all operate the same way. And I've been using the example of fast food. Like, they all have a McDonald's shingle out on the front, but back doors, there's like one's a McDonald's, one's a Taco Bell, one's a Burger King. They're kind of, and that's not to be disparaging at all. It's just to say that they're slightly different ways. They're all kind of, they look the same on the outside, but they're slightly different on the inside. So capacity matters. And then I would say the third thing, which has been echoed, is that equity matters. And that particularly for me, I talk about this as a woman of color, you know, equity matters and that it's important to lead with race. Because when we look at who is impacted not only by homelessness, but by every other kind of quote helping system, disproportionality and disparities around race are pretty shocking. And they feel even more shocking in a community like this that is diverse, but is also increasingly white. And so I would say, you know, data matters, capacity matters, and equity matters.
All right. I'm now going to turn it over to our audience. So I believe we have a couple of mic runners. Maybe? Yes? Okay. Okay. What I might ask you guys to do then is if we can have people just come up to the mic and form a line, and we'll have Mike kind of usher you in. I will say again, if you could keep your questions relatively short, that would be very, very helpful. I will probably cut you off at the 1 minute mark, so please don't make me do that.
Okay, well then what it missed was what is it going to do for our senior population? Because a lot of our seniors don't have enough money to live on.
Is there someone in particular who would like to take that question?
I'll say in the research I've done, we found that people on a fixed income, whatever that income source, it's extremely hard to think that rapid rehousing is an appropriate tool for someone with a fixed income.
We've found the exact same thing.
Is there anything going on at the city level to look at that particular issue, Catherine?
We're not looking, so our rapid rehousing investments have largely been with families and single adults. We're beginning to also think about what this looks like for youth, although young people are kind of very different in their own way. The city's sort of in by de facto attempt to really divert and prevent homelessness for elders is through our case management program and the work that we try to do to really support and wrap around older adults to make sure that they're not at risk of homelessness. It is not a rapid rehousing program. I want to be really super clear about that, but I appreciate you raising this because it could be something and should be something we're thinking about.
Next question.
I'm gonna go ahead and give someone else the mic. I'm so sorry. I'm gonna go to the side.
Hi there. First of all, thank you all. One big theme has been flexible funding and progressive engagement. The question I have is, Kevin, you had mentioned $2 million with the goal of housing 500 families at you know about $4,000 a family. Maybe I'm wrong there, but with you know between a security deposit, first and last month's rent, case management, all the background checks, it doesn't seem like it leaves a lot, and then paying for a couple months' rent, it doesn't seem like it leaves a lot for flexibility, for extending that or paying landlords a little bit more to help get people in. Just wondering, is the amount of money that we're setting aside for this program going to allow for successful rapid rehousing?
Thanks. Thank you.
Catherine, yeah, that's a great question. So just a minor clarification, it's roughly 500 households, because I know terms and clarification matters. And, you know, I think you raise a really good point in that the city has historically really invested a lot in our crisis response. And so it's been very challenging, quite frankly, to get sort of the political will to begin to make investments so that we are doing things with greater flexibility. But I am hopeful, although, you know, the $2 million that I referenced is a drop in the bucket, I'm hopeful that it begins to create a path for how we invest more and more towards kind of this flexible way of thinking about how we're doing our work. We're also doing some other sort of interesting things to try to build in flexibility with some of our kind of crisis response investments that are happening, and I appreciate you prompting it because it's a reminder that we need to do more. But it's just to be for real, it's been challenging. It's been very politically challenging to make that shift.
I want to thank you for doing such a good job of giving us a good feel for what the program can and cannot do. And as someone who used to work in a transitional housing program, my response to the Poppy report was, well, we don't have any data. And what if we, and I'm asking the researcher, what if you were to study 12 months worth of transitional housing versus 12 months worth of rapid rehousing? That would be the real comparison. And it would deal with people who have maybe one barrier to get back into housing versus people with many barriers who need more time and services. That's the study I want to see.
Rachel, I am going to let you answer that. I'm going to make a couple of clarifying points for people just so that people remember. Transitional housing is the model that basically gives a lot of services to help people be housed for around 1 or 2 years. Very supportive environment as opposed to rapid rehousing. The Poppy report is a report that came to the city from a national expert who is recommending we move money away from things like transitional housing to rapid rehousing. So Rachel, as a researcher, I'm going to let you respond to that request and question.
So my first response is that research also costs money. So if the invitation comes with some research funding, then we can talk about it. But while there are parts of the I think all of the consulting reports and the city's plan that I disagree with, I am pleased to see the advice to move away from transitional housing. That's something that I also feel like we actually already have a lot of data and information about, and it may not have been presented in the Poppy report in particular. And I would say that just because it doesn't show up as a cost-effective solution in a national research setting doesn't mean that it doesn't work for particular people. So this is not to deny anyone's experience of having succeeded through a transitional housing program. One thing that we know nationally about the way transitional housing is implemented is that it's often very restrictive and is very selective about who gets into it. So in terms of equity and accessibility, transitional housing, and on a national scale, I can't speak to any local experiences in particular, tends to be among the most selective of who they're even allowing to be in the program. So I think there's enough, personally, I think there's enough evidence that we don't actually need to study it more, and we can move to better research around some of these other interventions that we really haven't looked at yet.
Thank you very much.
Hi there. I'm a case manager in a single women's shelter at a nonprofit, faith-based, Salvation Army. My question is kind of a two-parter. You guys talked about self-selection or self-referral. Honestly, as a case manager, I'm still in the dark as to how the women are supposed to actually access the rapid rehousing kind of from beginning to end. So I understand they need to be verified as eligible, first off. So I think that happens at 211 and maybe some other places. But can you give us a general overview or idea of how the process works, just the actual self-referral piece of it?
Well, the coordinated entry now has Like there's five, I think it's five different regional access points where people can either walk into or set up an appointment through 211 to get assessed for a housing resource. My knowledge is primarily with families, but I think like youth and single adults can start accessing services through the RAPs, regional access points. So they're assessed and then they are offered a resource based on their responses to the ISPADAT.
Yes.
And then the participant ends up getting referred to that program. The program calls them to set up an intake appointment.
They call them, Rapid Rehousing does, so either Solid Ground, DESC, St. Vincent de Paul, or is there one more?
Yeah.
Lifeline.
I'm sorry, what?
So there's Solid Ground, St. Vincent de Paul, DESC, and there's one more, right? That does rapid rehousing in Seattle?
There's several. Yeah.
Okay.
So I think
I'd like to find out just more about it, and I have many questions, so I'll get back in line. but the answer is that you will call them.
Thank you for following the rules. Go ahead.
Hi. I'm wondering how the city of Seattle is either engaging now or planning to engage with people who have experienced homelessness or are experiencing homelessness in program development.
Yeah, that's a great question. So I would say that most of the work that we're doing around engagement, we're doing in partnership with All Home. All Home King County has been for a while now really intent on engaging folks who have experienced homelessness. I feel like it's always something that can be even more deep and rich. One of the things I'm really excited about is a conversation that we've been having with the Human Services Coalition to really think about what more authentic engagement with providers, but also want to think about what authentic engagement with individuals who have experienced homelessness looks like moving forward, recognizing that, you know, nonprofits can't do this work alone. Funders can't do this work alone. It really is going to take us sort of partnering in a different way. But the simple answer would be All Home has done a really amazing job connecting with people who've experienced homelessness, and that's really kind of the leverage point that we connect with them on.
And I'd like to piggyback on that by saying maybe you could come to one of our rapid rehousing focus groups and have that conversation with our participants and service providers. I think that's one method or one way of getting participant feedback on program development. I'm a big proponent of that.
So I'm kind of new to learning about a lot of this, so forgive me if this is kind of like a basic question, but what has the city done, like we just live in a really liberal city, have there been any policies introduced to try to either have like a certain percentage of new homes be like affordable or like having a rent cap or like how's that played out in this city?
So this is a space that I am not as sort of technically deep on, but definitely the housing and affordability and livability agenda, or also known as HALA, is intended to provide really kind of broad-based citywide policy direction around what it looks like to make more units available. And I want to acknowledge that there's some technical pieces just around zoning that is not my area of expertise. And it's been challenging for the city to engage in conversations with communities about that, what it means to be much more dense and inside of that density to create more affordable units. So I'm happy to follow up with you and get you some additional detail. A big part of renewing and doubling the housing levy this past year was intended to create additional resources for affordable housing to be developed.
And I'll just add, I can't really see who's in the room. I'll bet there are people in the room who know the ins and outs of this better, but the short answer is that there's nothing quickly that can be done to sort of mandate that the private market is including affordability in its units. There's a lot of strategies that are being pursued along those lines, and there are some programs that already exist and have existed in the city for a long time meant to increase affordability and that do increase affordability. And what we've mostly seen is that they're just small compared to where the housing market's going. So it's not necessarily that those strategies haven't worked, it's just that we've experienced so much growth that it's, you know, they're drowning. So, but it all happens at a very kind of piece by piece basis based on zoning and specific policies.
Good evening. Thank you so much for being here tonight. My name is Asha Mohammed, and as I was really attentively listening, like not a single panelist brought up about refugee and immigrant in this process. That's number one. Number two, y'all talked about heavily about equity and social justice in that sense. For somebody that experienced homelessness, that experienced the welfare system, that is a homeowner, and right now is working on homelessness, where does the conversation start about resilience of people? Where does it start talking about the shame of poverty? Where do we start talking about economic development for especially for these marginalized population? I really don't think they're marginalized. I just think our time is going to come. Have your 4 years. So my question is about capacity. And yes, that's really is what is keeping me up at night. My question about capacity is, how do we build a community that is not wrapped in white savior mode, but is grounded in uplifting humanity and really combating poverty? Because the root cause right here, it's about poverty. There is no way a family that is making $17,000, regardless if they are in Auburn, regardless if they are in Bellevue, regardless where they are. So my question really is, when are we gonna start having really the tough question, not for the marginalized people, but for all people?
Anyone in particular who'd like to?
I think that is an excellent question, and the conversation needs to start around human rights. Housing is an essential, fundamental right, regardless of your social, economic, racial status. You are human. You deserve to have housing. I think that's critical, and so I think sometimes we tend to shy away, or we forget that what we're talking about is in fact human rights and social justice, and we tend to operate in silos serving different communities, but really we want to develop a holistic system that addresses racism, poverty, while also uplifting and putting something in the place of what we want to eliminate, like such as housing discrimination. I think it again comes back to basic human rights and dignity. Starting the conversation there. I love having that conversation.
Anybody else?
I appreciate it. There you are. I was like looking for you. Hey, I appreciate your comments and just your courage and being for real about calling something, which I'm not from this community originally. I grew up in Toronto. And yes, I know, I'm not sure who I'm rooting for on Saturday, but what's interesting is that, you know, this is a community that, where race is a really interesting conversation, and that we've had some, we in the city, so I recognize I work in a system that is set up to operate in a certain way, and to perpetuate racism and institutionalized racism. And so there are things that we're attempting to do to kind of shift that. And yet, I'm also thinking about, like, what does it mean for us not just to be investing in services all the time? Because I think that that kind of keeps us in that mode. But what does it mean for us to, I talked about leaning in and really changing systems and having an impact. And the only sort of new thought that I'll offer based on what you shared is this notion around sort of a broader investment in community, and that it's broader than a social service investment. It's also about what does it mean for us not to have to sort of experience food, like all the stuff we know, food deserts and financial deserts, and just the disinvestment in community that has been happening for decades. So, and thank you for sharing. Yes, we didn't talk about immigrant and refugee communities, and yet it's something that, you know, we think we in the city think a lot about, and are really happy to be partnering with organizations who have that at their core mission as well.
Thank you.
This is a question I've had for quite a while, and having seen whole city blocks ripped out and high rises put in at $7,000 a month rent, and losing those jobs also, I just have a very simple question, and it's probably data driven. Is I'm curious, with the increase in homelessness we're seeing all over the city and the county, tents everywhere under every bridge and freeway. My curiosity is, who are the homeless? Are these people from Seattle and King County that have been losing their jobs and losing affordability all over the city, if not in their neighborhood when it got ripped down? All the numbers I've seen about the night count that happens, I've not really seen who are these people. Mm-hmm. Can you tell me that? Are they coming from our city and our county? Are they from out of county? Are they coming out of state? I'm just curious if that many people have been kicked out of their apartments and jobs in our city alone, is that what's happening here?
Thank you for your question. Rachel or Catherine or either of the service providers. Does anyone have an answer that they'd like to?
What's the data?
I would say it's all of the above. Folks, there are people experiencing homelessness in our community who were born in this community, and there are people who are experiencing homelessness in this community who came here. I would reckon that there are several people in this room who came to this community, and it's by the grace of God or whatever else you may believe in that we have the resources and support that we're still inside tonight. So I would say that it's all of the above. I think it becomes really dangerous almost when we're sort of parsing out, and I understand the curiosity, I totally do. I just think it sort of becomes a bit of a slippery slope to parse out sort of where people are from when I think about sort of who are they. And I'm not trying to be flip or anything, but I think it's all of the above. It's people who've lived here forever, and it's people who have come here.
And I'll echo Catherine's point, but from a different perspective, which is that rising rents are associated with increases in homelessness.
Right.
And that's true everywhere. So we see increases in homelessness all along the West Coast. We know that for years, the West Coast has been much more prosperous economically than the rest of the country. It's very challenging to know in a large scale who the homeless are for all sorts of reasons. I'm in conversations where people talk about, you know, maybe we should put GIS trackers on people and find out where they're from, right? Things that are totally inappropriate. But because it's a hard question, right? Because if you're homeless, you don't actually want people to find you if you're not in a place that you feel safe. So we can discuss kind of the data limitations there. But it's also, I think, to echo Catherine's point, you know, this is my third year that I've lived in Seattle. I don't know, am I from here? If I lost my job tomorrow, would I, you know, where does that make me from? And so, I mean, I think we're pretty confident. Most people don't come from homelessness elsewhere to homelessness here, mostly because they don't have the resources to move. But did they come within 6 months? Maybe. I don't. You know. I think again, all of the above.
Well, thanks, Rachel. I'm sorry. I'm gonna enforce the one question limit. My apologies. Do we have people on this side? Yeah.
In other states, it's illegal to be homeless with children. So a lot of homeless families from other states actually come to Washington because CPS won't take your children for being homeless in Washington state. So we do get other homeless families from other states migrating here for that very reason. But my thing is, I'm a housing and wellness advocate, and I won't mention which shelter that I work at because I'm not here on behalf of them. I'm just here as someone. So rapid rehousing, when our families get those referrals, they hate it. They can't stand it because we've had multiple families who are back into homelessness because of rapid rehousing and it wasn't successful for them. And they rather have a referral for transitional housing any day because it offers them support for at least 2 years while they can possibly get subsidized permanent housing during that time that they're there and figure out and have the support that they need. I want to know if there's any statistics or numbers for how many people have entered back into homelessness from rapid rehousing, or if we have those numbers to really show how it's been working.
So in the family option study that I referred earlier, transitional housing performed the worst of the interventions in terms of returns to homelessness. So, I mean, I can totally get that that doesn't necessarily resonate for clients, but the research shows that it is not in a long-term sense. It's certainly in the 2 years that you're receiving support, you are housed, right? So we could then talk about 2 years of rapid rehousing and it'll achieve the exact same thing in terms of security. The thing that makes transitional housing more controversial is the idea that the services provided will lead to housing stability in the future beyond those subsidies, and that's what the research does not support. So, yeah.
I think too that it's not a clear line between rapid rehousing and transitional housing, that in rapid rehousing, for the most part, an individual has a lease in their name. In transitional housing, they don't. So it's the difference between having a lease in your name and being housed and being in a supportive program and being homeless still. So what folks have found over time is that we don't want people to be homeless for any longer than they need to be. We also don't want people to be housed and not be able to pay their rent. So it always makes me nervous when I hear people compare the two, because it's an easy comparison because HUD wants us to replace one with the other, right? And it's not linear and it's not clear. And if I don't know if I should have said that, but if we continue, I think, to make that that line, it will just get more confusing, because what we need is supportive services that people select into that work for them, and to be flexible within those services, so.
And I would just offer that in 2015, of the households that were engaged in rapid rehousing, 5% returned to homelessness.
Catherine, is that in the city of Seattle that you're?
No, that's King County.
King County, okay. We have time for about two more questions, so I'm gonna call from one from either side. So please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. So I'm a housing specialist at a similar type program. It's not rapid rehousing, but you've talked about the two different parties. So you've got the clients and then you've got the landlords, and you're both trying to juggle both of their needs. But nobody's really talked about the third party, which is all of the other tenants in the building or all of the other people in the city who also should be engaged in this process. I mean, everyone wants the nonprofits to solve the homelessness issue, but really it's a citywide issue that we should all be participating in. And in my work, I've seen lots of our clients who get housed in an apartment building and it's great for the first few months, and their neighbors, maybe they notice that they look differently or their friends look differently because maybe they still have friends who are still homeless, and they get targeted. And so that ends up being a lot of pressure on the landlord as well to have to deal with these complaints they're getting and all this stuff. But I'm just wondering, how do we, and source of income protection is great in Seattle, and it doesn't exist everywhere, so we should be grateful that we have it. But how do we engage the general public in more accepting behaviors, or finding ways to just make sure that everyone's on board so that someone who does get housing isn't immediately discriminated against by their neighbors.
That's a big question. Who wants to tackle that one?
Well, my perspective is that to unlearn some of the preconceptions that we have been conditioned with and indoctrinated by, we have to do early intervention. So getting into classrooms, you know, elementary schools, and talking about what it means to be self-sufficient and what it means to have support systems and what it means to be anti-racist, anti-oppression, pro, you know, community. I think we need to start normalizing these principles at an early age so that it becomes a normal part of, it's normalized in society generally. I think early intervention isn't talked about enough and probably should be scaled up in addition to the interventions that we're talking about now, is also talking about how do we reach youth, and because they're the future, you know, of our services and of our country. So I'm a firm believer in like teaching skills, teaching attitudes, and community love and liberation to children when they're going to be the future of our services.
I would just echo what Catherine said earlier about trying to develop a more cohesive voice around the issue across sort of service areas and levels of government and kind of what, like, as a region, because I think, you know, what I said before about the disconnect between the housing and the services, and we could talk about disconnect between Seattle and our neighbors, you know, kind of whatever, but I think if there were an easier to understand message, that might also help.
I want to thank our panelists. Thank you very much for taking the time tonight to pass through this with us and to answer our questions. I want to thank Solid Ground as well, and I'm actually going to hand over to a Solid Ground member to wrap this up. Thank you.
Is it on? Oh, okay, it's on. Hi, everyone. thank you all for being here tonight. I wanted to quickly respond to one of the questions earlier about how to build more community and change perceptions in the community of poverty, about poverty. And tonight was really built intentionally. It was by design that we had a panel of funders, providers, and consumers, and that you didn't have to put your address in when you registered, and that there was no cost to attend, so that we could get more people and more perspectives in the room. And I really appreciate you all for coming out tonight. Thank you for joining this important conversation. Solid Ground believes that coming together as a community is sacred and that it's an important tradition of civic engagement. It connects us to a legacy of actions that have built up to progressive social change in our community. And it's not only how we honor the hard work and sacrifice of those who came before us, it's how we further the investments in our community and in social justice. So although we're at the close of this program now, tomorrow the conversations and the work will continue, and they'll be better because of everyone's questions and the participation of everyone tonight, so thank you. On your seat, you'll find a brief survey put together by All Home. This is an opportunity for you to share your input on how the strategies will be implemented, so please fill it out to share your thoughts. And also, you'll find a Solid Ground donation card. And there are staff standing around the room, too, who can help you, but please consider making a gift tonight. A donation of any size helps provide safe, stable housing for a person in need right now, so thank you. Also, we're hoping to have more community conversations just like this one, so you can help support us in making more of these evenings happen. And lastly, if you want to learn how to stay engaged or get engaged, pick up the phone and call Solid Ground, and you will most likely get me on the other line, and we're always happy to hear from you and happy to connect with you. So I hope you get home safely tonight, and thank you so much for coming out.